Well, thank you all for coming. It's really a great pleasure and honor, actually, to be part of this lecture series on our changing world. So that I will talk about in the coming hour is indeed actually quite close to my heart and also at the core of my current research agenda. So it is about behavioral economics and health behaviors. And as Philippa mentioned, one of the questions that we are trying to answer is, why is it the case that we indulge in sort of unhealthy behaviors? Why is it the case that we plan to exercise and then we don't go to the gym? Why is it the case that we don't stick to diets? Why is it so hard for us to actually adopt behaviors that should be good for us? And so this is a question that, of course, is asked by many people across many different disciplines. And so what I will try to do here is to tell you the angle from behavioral economics and from economics in general, and then zoom in into what behavioral economists have to bring to the table, to our understanding of these behaviors. So before actually I start, I just want to come back to a picture that was shown actually in the first lecture of this series, so by David Galley, who did this wonderful lecture on antibiotics, and of course then the focus was on infectious diseases. This is a picture that was commissioned by the Wellcome Trust, and that basically shows what people have died from in the 20th century. And so the bigger the circle, the more deaths you have associated with these type of diseases. And so, of course, he focused or sort of he pointed out that infectious diseases were very important and were very prevalent. And what we are going to do today is actually talk about so lifestyle behaviors, which are culprits or sort of candidate culprits for explaining other diseases that are also quite prevalent and quite important, but that are non-infectious. So non-communicable diseases like, for example, diabetes or cancer, cardiovascular diseases. These are the types of diseases that we are interested in not directly studying, but at least understanding how lifestyle behaviors can contribute to these diseases. Now, the World Health Organization actually pointed out recently that chronic diseases such as heart diseases, stroke, cancer, chronic respiratory diseases, and diabetes are actually by far the leading cause of mortality in the world, representing 60% of all deaths. It's actually double the number of deaths for all infectious diseases, so HIV, AIDS, tuberculosis, malaria, maternal and perinatal conditions, and hunger combined. Okay, so this is a very prevalent and very important public health issue. And they point out that actually the way to control these diseases are well known, and this is where there is perhaps a bit of debate of whether it is well known or not, but still lifestyle factors, so preventive measures, lifestyle factors, are often mentioned as ways we can actually act on to reduce the prevalence of these diseases. Also, perhaps interesting to point out is, contrary to the perception, it is not necessarily, we're not talking about diseases that are just prevailing in rich countries, in developed countries. These low and middle income countries actually hit the hardest in terms of consequences, particularly in terms of number of deaths. So if you can think about rich countries may have, you know, for example, better health care to actually deal with these diseases, and so we have more hope to actually fight and cope against these diseases, while low and middle income countries are perhaps less well equipped. So perhaps one first thing that may come to your mind when you think about this increasing prevalence of these non-infectious diseases and sort of chronic diseases or lifestyle diseases, we call them as well, is that maybe this is just the price to pay of having a longer lifespan. So we know that we have booked a lot of increase in terms of life expectancy. Our life expectancy, so this is a graph showing how life expectancy changed between 1841 and, 2001. And what you see is that we have pretty much doubled our life expectancy over the course of 150, 160 years, which is a remarkable achievement. And so perhaps we should just relax and think, well, these chronic diseases are just a consequence of us living longer. And of course, when we are older, we're more vulnerable and more likely to be exposed to these diseases. But this doesn't quite fit, actually, with other evidence that exists. So a first thing that I want to show here is coming from something called the Medical Expenditure Survey, it's US data, that shows the prevalence of chronic conditions according to age. And so, of course, the first thing is perhaps sort of fits with what we would expect, although I must say that the magnitude is not quite as much as I expected, is much more than I expected when I first looked at the data. You have 91% of the people who are 65 or older who are affected, who have one or more chronic conditions, which is a very, very high prevalence. But when you look at sort of younger groups, so say take the ages 20 to 44, you see that about 40% of them also have a chronic condition. And so this is where you sort of start wondering, well, is it the case that this is really just a price to pay of, you know, living longer? It doesn't seem to be quite convincing. It seems that indeed younger people are also affected by these diseases. And also when we look at how this changed over time and how the prevalence of these diseases have changed over time, it's also interesting to point out that actually, yes, we do see that the fact that younger people are now affected by these chronic diseases seems to also have been increasing over time. So this graph shows you the cumulative incidence of diabetes from three UK birth cohorts. So it shows you how many people are affected by chronic diseases depending on their age and when they were born. So what you can see is that if you were born in 1946, there was pretty much no diabetes until you would reach the age of 16, and then you start having an increase in the prevalence of diabetes. But when 1958, you already see that the onset comes earlier. In 1970, again, the sort of younger generation, we see that diabetes start appearing as early as 4 years old. You start having very, very young children who have diabetes. So that's the first thing. So now it seems clear, you know, to everyone in the room that we have changed. So over time and over the course of evolution, we have changed, and our lifestyle has changed quite drastically. So our lifestyle has changed. So we used to spend a lot of time outside and involved in physical activity to get our food, and now we are spending most of our time sitting or having a sedentary lifestyle, sitting at our desk, watching TV, and so on. We don't have to put as much physical effort anymore to actually get the food that we need to survive. Also, in terms of nutrition, there has been quite a drastic change from a situation where food was not widely available, food was scarce, we had to work hard to actually find food, and if we would find food, it would be actually natural whole foods, to a situation now where food is actually widely available, at least in rich countries, and comes in all sorts of forms. In particular, there is a lot of what we call processed food, so foods that doesn't come in, say, its natural state anymore, but has been processed by an industrial process. And then, among other life factors that people talk about and that might possibly be relevant to influence the prevalence of these diseases, there is stress, smoking behavior, and alcohol consumption. So these are the sort of the main candidates for explaining increases in what we will call risk factors that themselves lead to diseases. I must say that my expertise is not at all in trying to explain the relationship between lifestyle and risk factors and chronic diseases in turn. there are much more qualified people than me to do this. What I'm interested in is, at least as an economist, what I'm interested in is to try to understand what determines lifestyle behaviors. So can we actually understand better why people indulge or why people adopt these unhealthy lifestyles? So, but anyway, so we understand that we are in this world where lifestyle factors such as nutrition, stress, exercise, tobacco use, and alcohol may contribute to risk factors that then determine chronic diseases. But we also understand, and I want to get this straight away, that we understand that lifestyle factors are not the only determinants of these diseases, that they could be other environmental factors that are likely to be relevant, age or genetic factors are likely to play a role as well. But anyway, so we get to these risk factors, and risk factors are things like high cholesterol, high blood pressure, obesity, tobacco addiction, and so on. And that could lead actually to a number of what we call chronic diseases that have been labeled actually diseases of affluence because they seem to increase in prevalence with economic development. And so it's a little bit, there's something a bit ironic to this, that you see that when we develop and we get richer, we seem to at the same time get a lot of new diseases that we didn't have before. What I found striking when I first looked at these studies and this literature is that there is a lot of attention in the media talking about so obesity, cardiovascular diseases, and so on, diabetes, but perhaps a bit less about other chronic conditions that also seem to be, at least have been related in studies to lifestyle factors. Things like cancer, stroke, osteoporosis, dementia, Alzheimer's, and so on and so on. So there's lots of possible chronic diseases we can have, but anyway, it seems that pretty much all say big diseases that are currently prevalent, at least in rich countries, so putting aside the infectious diseases in poorer countries, are actually potentially caused, at least partially, by lifestyle factors. Now, the irony is, and this is why I also mentioned that it was a bit ironic that these diseases have been called diseases of affluence, because first of all, as I mentioned earlier, it seems that poor and middle-income countries are actually the most affected by these diseases. But if we look in actually almost all countries, it is going to be the case that it is the poorest people who are most at risk of developing these chronic diseases and dying prematurely from them. So if we look at, this is again sort of looking at a statistic that tells you, well, how much more likely are you to have a chronic disease when you have a high education degree versus when you have a low education, when you have low education. So that means you have no post-secondary education. This is, of course, a proxy with income and with poverty. So it is just to show you that the flavor of what we get when we look at this type of statistics is that you are much more likely to get a disease when you are low educated than when you are high educated. So, for example, if you take the group of 25 to 59 years old, what this number tells you is that you are 1.89 times more likely to get a stroke if you have low education than if you have high education. Okay, so you are much more likely to get pretty much all diseases except for allergies. There's something about allergies that seem to be targeting more the high educated. These numbers are a bit smaller when it comes to the older groups. We have to keep in mind that there is also potentially a selection effect here that, of course, if you are dying earlier of these diseases, then the group surviving and reaching this sort of older age is going to be selected. But anyway, it is still the case that we still find that overall it seems that high-educated people are less likely to get ill than low-educated people. So that means that for me at least, or for behavioral economists who are interested in this area, the big questions are, well, how did we get where we are? So why is it the case that we actually choose these lifestyle behaviors that are bad for us? And also, we somehow need to have an explanation of why is it the case that poor people are more vulnerable and are more perhaps likely to engage in these unhealthy lifestyle behaviors. So I'll start by taking a step back, actually, before talking about behavioral economics. I'll talk to you about how economists would approach health-related behaviors. So the key building blocks we are going to use, and I suppose that economists, so first of all, before I go into this, you may wonder why is an economist actually interested in health-related behaviors, and why don't we leave that to actually people who know something about health and diseases and so on, which I think is a fair point. So economists have perhaps, you know, this bad trait that they think they can comment on anything. But in this case, we are interested in choice, and we're interested in understanding decision making across a wide range of domains. So we are interested in understanding why people make the choices that they make. So perhaps you would associate more decision making in terms of saving decisions, investments, and so on with economics, but actually economists have also studied things like why do we go to college, sort of decisions that are perhaps outside the prime order decisions that you would put in economics. So we also are interested in things like decision to marry, decision to to go to college, or things like what do you eat, whether you exercise or not. This is a choice that we make, and we are interested in understanding what is happening and what are the determinants of these choices. Now, it's also interesting that economists will also sort of see that there might be some interesting commonalities between, say, choices that a priori look like they are coming from very different domains. So, for example, the decision to go to college may seem like it has really nothing to do with the decision of whether to go to the gym or not, or whether to actually save money for next year. But actually, what we see is that there are commonalities, in the sense that we see that it's the same, the people who are more likely to save money are also the ones who are more likely to go to college, and are also the ones who are more likely to exercise. And so the question then, or perhaps, you know, an interesting hypothesis is to think, is there something common to this behavior? Is there a mechanism that might be behind these decisions that is actually shared by all these different decisions, even though they are in different domains? So we approach choices as the outcome of a kind of internal cost and benefit analysis. And so let me just be clear here. It's not that we really think that people are going out there with their calculator and trying to figure out what is actually the best, you know, option. We understand that it's not what people are doing. But somehow we want to sort of have this premise or assumption that if people choose to exercise versus not exercising, it must be somehow that the benefits of exercising are somehow higher, that they sort of think that this is a good thing for them, that they prefer to exercise versus not exercising. Now, there are interesting characteristics of health-related behavioral choices, which, as I just briefly mentioned, will be actually interesting when we make a comparison with other types of decisions, like a saving decision or the decision to go to university. The first characteristic is that these behaviors, these choices, are intertemporal in nature, meaning that you take a decision, you make a choice today, and that will have implications not only now, but also in the future. So if I decide, you know, to eat burgers for the rest of my life, it will have implications for my chances of getting a heart attack later on down the line. Okay, so these implications are later on in time. And it's the same with a saving decision. In a sense, you save now. That means that you will be able to consume more later. So the benefits of your saving decision are actually coming later on down the line. And the same with education, you are getting a degree, and so you're sort of incurring immediate costs now by sitting here and listening to me. But later on down the line, you will get benefits, perhaps, you know, find a job that will have a higher pay and so on. And then the second interesting characteristic that is again shared across these different domains is uncertainty. So that means that there is not clear what the benefits are going to be. There is uncertainty about what these benefits and costs will be in the future. So, for example, it's not clear that if I eat burgers now for the next 4 weeks, that I will be at a higher risk of a heart attack later on. Okay, so we all know, we all have an uncle or a grandmother who seem to be smoking 50 cigarettes a day and is perfectly fine. And so there is not this one-to-one mapping between your behavior and the consequences. And again, that's something that is similar in a saving or in an education decision where, you know, if you save, you don't know, there might be another banking crisis or there might be something else happening that you're not too sure what you will get as a benefit later on. And the same with education, you don't know whether you are going to find a job, what kind of job you're going to find, how high your salary will be, and so on. So that's, again, that's quite interesting because that means that, you know, how much you like risk may matter quite a bit in your decision. If you dislike risk and are really afraid of taking risks, you might be choosing an option that is indeed more safe. And in that, in the case of health-related behaviors, we have a good case to make, I think, to say that the safe option is actually to adopt a healthy behavior. Now, if I try to sort of portray this, by the way, this is not the way our papers look like in general. We use mathematical models to describe people's choices and consequences. But actually, I do think that it's very possible to convey the intuition and the mechanism behind these models that we are using nice pictures and figures. So this is what I'm gonna do here. So the idea is that suppose we are thinking about, you know, this is just an example about exercising versus watching TV. So you're making, you know, these choices on every day. You can choose whether you're going to exercise, you know, for the rest of time. And then at the end, you hope that you might have perhaps a longer life and be more healthy. If you choose, on the other hand, to watch TV for the rest of your life every day, then the chances are that you will be in less better health and that you might actually live shorter. Okay, so this is a way of portraying this sort of costs and benefits that might be that might be intervening in your decision. So what are these costs and benefits? So they are obviously the first thing that you can think of is that there might be immediate cost and benefits, so immediate implications of your choices. So if you want to go jogging, you actually have to put your training shorts on and you have to go outside and it's cold and it's just painful to go and run. You have this sort of a sweat and everything, so it's sort of perhaps not so appealing. So this is an immediate cost. Might be also some benefits, like for example, you get more endorphin and you sort of feel happier once you have exercised. That might be again an example of something that is an immediate benefit. Now, when we think about watching TV, you can think that the immediate benefit that you get is the enjoyment of just sitting there and watching TV. Now then, what is interesting is that we also, it seems sort of interesting to think about long-term effects that people may also take into account in their decisions. So if the people who are exercising are presumably exercising because they think that it will keep them healthy, and so later on they will have a healthier body, they will have a longer expected life, and lower chances of diseases. On the other hand, if you watch TV the whole time, then what you may end up with is an unhealthier body, shorter expected life, and higher chances of diseases. So first thing that I would like to point out, and I will come back to that when I talk about behavioral economics because it's going to be quite important, is that the choices that you make is actually not between exercising for the rest of your life and watching TV for the rest of your life. It's between exercising today and watching TV today, which means that you could very well think, well, I'm going to go exercising from tomorrow on. Today I'm watching TV, but tomorrow I'm going to go and exercise. Okay? But anyway, so this is the way we would sort of think about these decisions and costs and benefits. And so economists like to talk about what we call utility, but the idea is that we are interested in thinking about how about well-being and how decisions may affect your well-being. So this cost and benefits, in a sense, make you better or worse off, and that's this trade-off that we want to portray. So just to put it simply, imagine here, and again, this is just an example. I think that most of us will relate to this, the way that this example looks like, but jogging may not be that appealing today in comparison to watching TV, but 40 years down the line, it's going to be the case that you are going to be healthier and have a lower chances of disease. So presumably, your well-being will be higher if you choose to exercise than if you don't. Now, one thing, first thing to notice is that, and again, it's something that economists have studied a lot, and we know across a variety of domains that this is true, that the future is discounted. So in a sense that I always like the example of children, because I think we all can relate to that giving a chocolate bar to my nephew in 1 hour is not the same as giving him the chocolate bar immediately. It's worth less to him to actually get the chocolate bar in 1 hour than getting it immediately. And so this is this idea that somehow the future, this future benefits, in a sense, if I try to translate them into what they are worth for me now, they are worth less than they will be when I'm at that point in time. Okay, so the future is discounted. Why is it interesting to point that out? It's because, of course, the extent to which I discount these future benefits, which means that they shrink in a sense, is going to matter for my, say, overall evaluation of whether it's a good idea or not. Or just putting it simply, if I don't care about the future and I really don't care about getting cancer or cardiovascular diseases or anything, it's the equivalent of basically I don't really mind at all, I don't care about these benefits in the future, then they will not come into play in my cost and benefit analysis. So the more I discount, the more likely I am to actually pick, in this case, the watching TV option, the unhealthy option. Now, the second thing that I'd like to mention, coming back to the sort of the second element that characterizes these decisions, is this idea that some of these benefits occur in the future and are uncertain. Okay, so that means there is some risks associated with it. So in a sense, eating a burger is a little bit like playing a gamble. You just don't know. It might be that you increase your chances of becoming sick, but it's not a one-to-one effect. Okay, so this is why when I talked about these long-term consequences, I talked about having a longer expected life. So it's something that is not certain. It's just, it might be that you are hit by a bus and you've been jogging, for 40 years and then you die, in an accident. So there is no guarantee that you will actually live longer, but in expectations, you should live longer. And similarly, you should have lower chances of diseases. So that again is sort of interesting because you can think that maybe if we have more people who are more likely to take risks are perhaps more likely than to choose these unhealthy behaviors. This reasoning you can apply to pretty much sort of all the, say, lifestyle behaviors I mentioned in the introduction. So you can think about, healthy diet or about smoking, about alcohol consumption and so on. So now we can use this framework to sort of try to think, well, why is this the case that then I will observe people choosing, say, the unhealthy behavior over the healthy behavior? So the first thing is you could say, well, they actually like it. They really like, to watch TV in comparison to just jogging. So that's why they will pick that. It could also be that there is the valuation of their future is such that they prefer the unhealthy behaviors. In particular, if they discount the future a lot, so if they don't care about the future, then you might be perhaps more likely to choose the unhealthy behavior. Or if you're more of a risk taker, then it might also be that you choose more the unhealthy behavior. And again, as I said, because we find these correlations in behavior across different decisions, what people have now and are trying to study and understand is whether indeed things like risk preferences or time preferences, so how patient you are, whether these could be key determinants of these behaviors. And one thing that indeed seemed to be the case is that it is true that there is heterogeneity in the population, and that, for example, it is well known that there is a correlation between, say, education levels and degrees of risk-taking and patience, so time preferences. So potentially we have here, we are into something to try to explain also differences across income groups. Then the last point that is obvious as well, I didn't mention it while I was going through the example, but that of course if you what could determine your choice is whether it is available or not. So this is something that a lot of people worry about when we talk about why low-income people may not be eating a lot of fruit and vegetables. Is it the case that they actually have fruit and vegetables available in their neighborhood and so on? Can they actually access these healthy foods? Budget and prices are obviously very important as well and will be direct determinants of this cost-benefit analysis. So if you cannot afford it could be that healthy choices are more expensive, that eating healthily is more expensive, and that's why you actually choose then to eat unhealthily. So what is important here at this point to realize and to understand is that choosing watching TV over jogging is not a wrong decision in the sense of it's not an irrational or crazy decision. It's the option that actually makes the individual best off. Okay, so it's what people want to do. And it could very well be the case in the sense that people are very, understand the game, they understand the gamble, and they think, I know that I may be at risk of having a cardiovascular disease, but I'm ready to take this risk and I want to enjoy my burger today. Okay, so that could be what is going on. And I'll just come when we come to behavioral economics, we'll see that actually it doesn't seem to be that this is the whole story and that this is so convincing. But anyhow, it could be that this is a plausible story. Now, in terms of if we understand these determinants of behavior, we can also use that to perhaps suggest possible policies. So policies that could steer your behavior in a direction of, say, more healthy or healthier behavior. So you could think about changing prices. So the changing how the various option cost will obviously affect your sort of internal cost and benefit analysis. So it could be things like the fat tax or cigarette tax are things that policymakers have thought about to try to steer people in the direction of being adopting healthier lifestyle. It could also be that you want to manipulate the choice set, so you can perhaps forbid certain foods. So for example, we forbid the access to alcohol for people who are under the age of 21. That's an example of actually limiting their choice set through regulation. Or you could perhaps impose for certain foods to be offered in school canteens. That's another example of manipulating the choice set. Now, it could also be, and I want to come back on sort of these determinants of your decisions. One important factor that I haven't mentioned much yet, but that might be playing quite an important role, is the information that you have when you take a decision. And so in particular, what at least economists are going to call rational is when you take the decision that makes you better off, given the information that you have at the time where you make your decision. But it could be that this information is not completely correct. So, for example, it could be that you have wrong beliefs, you don't know the link between lifestyle and health. It's certainly something that we know from smoking, for example, that it took quite a while for people to understand and realize that there was a link between smoking and diseases. And so if you do not know, and we know it's hard enough for people who actually study this scientifically, the link between lifestyle and diseases, it could be that people have wrong beliefs about their chances of getting sick. It could be that they systematically underestimate, for example, their chances of becoming sick. And in that context, then providing information might be helpful and could be welfare improving. So in a sense that people will then take, say, better decisions, decisions that make them better off because they now have better information available. And examples of policy interventions that fall into this category are the information campaigns that we all know, so things like, you know, eat five a day, or all this information that we get about how bad smoking is for our health. Now, the trouble with all this, and so it's all very nice to think about, you know, how indeed putting this economic lens on this behavior is, I think, quite helpful to understand possible reasons for why people may indulge and engage in unhealthy behaviors. But actually, the reason why perhaps behavioral economics became quite popular and is increasingly popular, I think, also among policy circles, is because there is actually some evidence that people seem to be unhappy actually with their choices. They would really like, and you know, I'm probably among these people, I would really like to exercise, you know, three times a week and follow these recommendations, but it's just hard. And we're just not happy. We would like, it actually would be the sort of an ideal world what I would like to do, but somehow we don't manage to do that. And so it's something that is well established actually in a wide range of domains, is that people do not seem to be able to stick to their plan and tend to procrastinate. And so the question is, why is that? What is going wrong? That suggests some kind of internal conflict. So there's something that is going on and that we would like to understand. So the question is, where did we go wrong? Now, I'm going to talk a little bit about the maladaptation hypothesis, even though I'm not fully, you know, comfortable, because this is going a bit beyond my area, and I know that there are people in the room who are way better qualified to talk about that than me. But we know that we have, we have biological mechanisms that steer our behavior in sort of a prime order manner. So we feel hungry, we feel satiated, we actually have taste for bitter taste, salt, sweet, and so on, that steer us towards certain foods and actually tell us, look, you should eat. And you know, it's kind of nice that we have this biological mechanism telling us and informing us that we should eat, and tell us as well when we should stop eating. Okay, so that's sort of very nice that we have evolved, and these biological mechanisms have evolved to help us to survive. And in a sense, in sort of an evolutionary context, you would hope that these biological mechanisms have been developed to maximize your chances of survival, meaning that in this context, perhaps you want to get the most nutritious food possible at the least possible cost. So that means you want to actually save on energy, on physical energy in particular, as much as possible. So that means that we'll also have, you know, indicators that we should not, you know, we should try to minimize effort. And that's why effort is, you know, painful and we are tired. And so this is sort of a fundamental, I think, fundamental mechanism that allowed us to survive for a long time. Now, the problem is that we have faced very drastic technological improvements in a very, very short amount of time. And certainly in the light of, you know, looking at the history of evolution, we're looking at a very, very short window of time. So first, we have now a much wider availability of food. We don't have, food is not scarce anymore, at least in rich countries. So we don't have to struggle much. We're not going through famines. We just can find food whenever we want. And then the second thing is that the food has sort of changed as well, so it's processed in a certain way. It's not anymore the sort of the whole natural foods that we used to have. And again, even though so I'm not qualified to talk about whether we have, you know, these biological mechanisms that steer us towards certain foods like fats and sugar and so on, but what I can tell you as an economist is that if these mechanisms exist, there is certainly a market and an industry that will develop and try to cater to these tastes. And the second aspect of it, so on the side of nutrition, is that we can also now survive with very low physical input. We don't have to run around and hunt for food or work in very hard in fields for the whole day. Most of us are just commuting by car or sitting at a desk for most of the time. So we have now managed to produce food at very low cost, and we have wide availability of food. So one hypothesis then, sort of sensible, perhaps reasonable hypothesis, is that we are perhaps maladapted to the current environment, so that these biological mechanisms are not adapted to the current circumstances because the changes have happened too fast. Now again, so if I bring this back to sort of my little representation of our model that I had earlier, that's sort of something that As economists, we find, you know, we are quite comfortable incorporating into our models, thinking about, well, of course you have this impulse and these immediate benefits that may steer you in one direction or the other, and so this is the way we want to perhaps incorporate this idea that biology steers us in a certain way. But what is interesting is perhaps in the past you could think that the biology would actually steer us in a direction that used to be good for you. So in a sense, the choices that would make you better off overall, but it's not anymore. So it suggests some kind of conflict between perhaps impulses and cognition. So this is the idea that maybe that we recognize all that your head says salad, but your heart says burger when you're in front of this choice. And so what is interesting then to try to think about is that there are potentially psychological mechanisms or other mechanisms at work that may determine who will win. And one important area of research in psychology and also in behavioral economics is, for example, to understand the role of self-control. So how much control people can have on these impulses. And it's again sort of trying to have indeed this cognition winning over impulses. Now, on top of that, and this is again something that comes from quite a lot of evidence from psychology and from behavioral economics, that on top of these reasons why we may go wrong because of biology, it seems that we also suffer from a number of decision-making biases. And so just to tell you in a nutshell what behavioral economics is, behavioral economics stems actually from the experimental evidence suggesting that people's choices are not always rational. And I know that most people in the audience always think, well, only economists think that people are rational anyway. I think I like to take this opportunity actually to say that it's not necessarily the case, but we are what we hope, at least what we hope to achieve with a model that assumes that people are rational, is that their behavior may actually deviate from that, but as long as it doesn't deviate in a systematic manner, it's sort of fine for us. We still have a model that predicts behavior quite well on average. The trouble arises when you actually see deviations in a systematic manner. So it's the case that people are all systematically deviating from what we would predict would be the sort of the rational thing to do. And that seems to be, having been established in a number of domains. And so what then behavioral economists are trying to do is to try to build better model and try to understand, well, what is really going on? What is the reason why we observe these biases? So the point is that if we have these biases, then individuals who are not fully rational and so might suffer from these biases have difficulties actually achieving the behavior they actually prefer, okay? And that's the reason why I think behavioral economics has become a success story among policymakers, partly, not only because part of the policies actually are perhaps cheap policies and don't need to require much, you know, government spending. That's one aspect. But the other aspect is that it's actually a little bit, you know, easier to sell a policy that says that it will help you to make the choices that you would like to make anyway, rather than a policy that will constrain you in a certain way. So I'll talk about two types of behavioral biases. Actually, by the way, this is just giving you a little overview of you know, important behavioral biases that might be at work. There are a lot of biases that people have, unfortunately, and have been established in psychology and behavioral economics. But I'll just mention a few which I think are quite important and relevant for when it comes to health-related behaviors. So the first type of biases are biases that I would call biases in valuation or in preferences, so in the way we actually evaluate things. And the second is biases in cognitive processing, so the way we actually do this internal cost and benefit analysis. So when it comes to first behavioral biases in preferences or valuation, I'll talk about three different types of bias. One is what we call the present bias. The second is status quo or endowment bias, and context effects. So present bias is the one I think we'll all relate to. Is this idea that we make these plans that, you know, actually I really want to go, you know, I will really want to go and exercise, and from tomorrow on I'll go and exercise. And this looks like the great plan. But today I feel a little bit tired, it's been a long day, I'm just gonna stay and watch TV. But from tomorrow on, I'm going to exercise. And the issue with this is that actually that's perfectly fine. You know, it could be that this is your choice and, you know, this is what you do. The problem arises when actually tomorrow comes and you're pretty much feeling like today. You feel like, well, actually, I'm also tired today. But tomorrow, I guarantee I'm going to start this exercise, you know, regime. And this is something I think we are all familiar with. We've all been there, and we know that it is something quite robust, that people make plans that they don't stick to. Actually, across, again, a range of domains, not just specific to health-related behaviors. So we don't have this ability to commit. Now it's interesting when you think about, you know, if this is at work, and we know it's actually at work and quite relevant in a wide range of domains, that also tells you that the type of policies you could use and you could design is actually quite interesting and potentially different from what I presented before. So one thing that you could do is offer people ways to commit to certain options. So there is an interesting website, actually, that has been designed by economists in the US, which is called STICK. And what it does, and I recommend, you know, you go to it afterwards if you have a plan that you have trouble implementing, is that you can actually say, well, this is my plan. I want to lose, I don't know, 10 pounds. And then you actually can sign up a friend who will monitor your progress, and who, if you actually do not implement your plan, will receive some money that you have pre-committed. And I know some people in the room have tried to to do this, and I'm not sure. I think it was successful, actually. So this is an example of an instrument you could use. Also, the other another instrument that you could use is to say, well, if you are really, you know, today is very special and you are putting a lot of weight on how you feel today, and you have this bias towards the present costs and benefits, then what we can do also is to perhaps make the healthy option more attractive today. So give you little incentives that make the healthy option more attractive today. And this is something that has been done, again, across a number of domains. So there is a study, for example, where they paid people to go to the gym for a while and actually so looked at whether they were developing a habit. But so the idea was to make sort of to exploit the fact that we have this present bias, that we might really look at the immediate costs and benefits more than we look at the future to steer people in a certain direction. And yes, yeah, so people have tried to develop models that explain, so this what we call a time inconsistency, so the fact that you're not consistent with yourself, that you change your plans and so on. And so, yeah, so this is the type of models and changes that we try to implement. Now, I just want to point out that the difference with, say, a rational approach to the problem would be, so if you have no present bias, it's perfectly fine, again, to make this choice today of, you know, watching TV and not going jogging and think that you are going to go tomorrow. But then you, what we should actually see is that you do implement this plan tomorrow. And this is so the problem, and I think the interesting question for economists is that we see that people renege on their plans. And so we're trying to understand why and what is the case. Now another perhaps interesting bias that psychologists and behavioral economists have identified is this idea of status quo and endowment bias. So this is the idea that somehow when you have something, so you are used to, for example, a certain diet or you're used to whatever, I'm giving you a good, you have a good in your hands, you actually value changes in a positive manner or sort of getting something differently than you value changes going, sort of things that are removed from you. So that may seem obvious. Obviously, one is positive and the other is negative. But the idea behind this is that if I give you £1, you know, your well-being will increase by a certain amount. You feel good about getting this £1. But this increase is actually lower than the decrease in well-being you would incur if I take £1 away from you. So somehow these losses weigh more heavily than the gains. And that's, again, perhaps interesting. So when it comes to, again, health-related behaviors, and think about diet, for example, suppose that the status quo is you are eating, you know, a bunch of junk food and a few fruit and vegetables, and I'm trying to convince you to change diet. Well, it will be much harder for you to give up on this, you know, junk food, the things that you have, so losing things, rather than actually adding things to your diet, like adding fruit and vegetables, maybe a sort of an easier sell. And so this is what perhaps, again, can inform policy and can inspire policymakers to sort of think about, well, instead of, you know, trying to remove things from people's diet, maybe what we should do is tell them what they should add to their diet. Another last, maybe less prime order, but kind of intriguing bias, which again has been established quite well in psychology and behavioral economics, is this idea of context effects. And this is the idea that somehow things that should not be relevant are all of a sudden going to influence your choice. So suppose that I'm showing you these three wonderful desserts, which is probably not a good idea this time of the day, but but suppose this is the choice, and suppose that most people would actually prefer the cake in the middle. Okay, so most people would choose the cake. Now, suppose that the next thing that I'm asking people to do is to choose between that cake and a fruit salad. Now, again, suppose this is what I'm sort of assuming what would happen, is that now suppose that most people would actually prefer the fruit salad. Okay? So they prefer the fruit salad over the cake. Now, what is troubling is that if you offer them another menu where you have the cake again and the fruit salad again, and then we bring back these things that you actually that people didn't like that much, or at least they preferred the cake to, then it seems that now all of a sudden people are more likely to choose the cake again. And that's very, very hard for us to understand what is happening. So it seems that somehow the context, so the fact that there are more unhealthy options available, makes you more likely to go for the unhealthy option that you perhaps prefer among these unhealthy options. So that's, again, something that seems, you know, intriguing. I don't think we understand quite well, you know, what is happening, but it's certainly the case that for policy, it seems, again, easy to see how you could use this to your advantage, or at least to steer people in a particular direction. So by, for example, increasing the number of healthy choices on a menu, if that alone may increase the fact that you may choose a healthy option, even though all the other options are in fact dominated by one, is kind of interesting. Now I'm going to talk about behavioral biases in cognitive processing. And this is something I find quite interesting, and also particularly when we talk about why is it the case that poor people might be more likely to engage in unhealthy behaviors, is potentially quite an appealing explanation. So the idea is that, well, we have, you know, limited cognitive resources, and so it's all nice, this idea of this cost-benefit analysis, but we just, you know, most of the time we don't have time to sort of think about the consequences of our decisions. And if I'm going to the canteen, I'm just picking something and I'm just using some heuristics or some simple decision rules to choose what I'm going to eat. So this idea of limited cognitive resources means that perhaps in some circumstances you are acting perhaps more as a sort of automatic pilot. So that means you're more likely to go for the things that are salient. Again, something that has been widely established, that if something is salient, people are more likely to go for it. It's the example of, you know, the chocolate bars being at the cashier. It's something that people see that is salient. Also, the fact that you stick to what you know. So this is potentially a very important, you know, explanation for why we have very strong habits, that we all eat the same over and over again. So I was reading recently that actually the British population is surviving on average 5 recipes, so per family. So it's sort of worrying, but we stick to what we know. We sort of don't have, maybe don't want to invest all these cognitive resources and figure out other things. We stick to the default, again, something that is very well established, that if you have a default option, people will more likely to take this default option. Even if you start changing, you know, which option is the default, you always see a persistence of this default option. Again, something very popular among policymakers, because you can think this seems quite cheap, actually. Let's put the broccoli next to the cashier, and that may increase, you know, the choices of broccoli. Or changing the default option, you know, it seems also relatively easy to do. Now, I'm coming to policy, and I think it's important to actually finish with this, is I think that behavioral economics has been quite successful at reaching the public and reaching policy circles, partly because there are some very nice economists who have done quite a lot of work to try to actually get their work known and get the behavioral economics known among the public and policy circles. For example, there is this book called Nudge by Richard Saylor and Cass Sustin, which basically popularized behavioral economics as a possible, you know, way of getting insights into people's behavior and designing more suitable policies. There is, both in the US and the UK, there is a nudge unit that has been formed. So the Behavioral Insights Team is the UK version that is directly under, well, the Cabinet Office of David Cameron. So as I said, I think that nudges have been quite popular, and I want to talk a little bit about nudges, even though, and this is what I will point out on the next slide, it is not the only policy instrument you could think about when you think about what instruments can we come up with based on the insights from behavioral economics. But anyway, so what is a nudge? Because something that a lot of people are talking about, and it's not always, you know, very well defined in the public domain. So I'm taking the definition by Hausmann and Welsh in the Journal of Political Philosophy, which I think fits with, I think, most behavioral economists would agree are nudges. So nudges are ways of influencing choice without limiting the choice set, or making alternatives appreciably more costly in terms of time, trouble, social sanctions, and so forth. So they are called for because of flows in individual decision making, and they work by making use of those flows. So it's important to realize that the idea behind nudges is that you are not changing the choice set. So in a sense, you know, we are not changing whether people can actually have chips or not. We are just changing, for example, how salient they appear or how salient they are in their choice set. We're also not changing the prices. We're not changing the incentive structure. It's not that we are putting a tax on fat, for example, is not a nudge, because you are changing the incentive structure. And what is interesting also to realize with this is that these nudges, so for example, changing the default option or changing what is salient and so on, only works if we have these behavioral biases. If we don't have these behavioral biases, so if we actually always, our choices are always the results of some kind of internal cost and benefit analysis, then clearly we would not be influenced by them. We would not, it wouldn't matter what is actually salient or what is at the cashier or not. That would not matter for our decisions. But they are, so this is what perhaps for better or worse, so behavioral economics has been popularized in the public and has been sometimes reduced to this idea of using nudges. So I want to perhaps here finish with saying that behavioral economics is not just about nudges. So as I mentioned during the talk, other types of instrument that you could use that are, again, exploiting or inspired by insights from behavioral economics is use the idea of short-term immediate incentives that make the healthy behavior more attractive, perhaps for a period of time, and then perhaps this is going to be sufficient for having people develop different habits. Okay, so the idea of using short-term incentives, the idea of using commitment devices, so the idea of having this plan where you have, you know, some money that will go to your friend if you don't respect your plan is another example of something that that is inspired by behavioral economics. Also, we have no issue to think about, you know, regulation as being a possible implication of these insights. So obviously, if we know that we have trouble sticking to our plans, again, you know, regulation could help make sure that we stick to our plans so that we don't have these choices available in our choice set. So it's coming back to, you know, manipulating the choice set is again a possible intervention. And taxes and subsidies are also possible things that could be used and could be again playing on the incentive structure and could be again perhaps helping people to make the choices that they would like to make. Yes. Now I want to come back briefly to information campaigns because here it's quite important, and I think there's lots of public health campaigns that are indeed organized around the idea of providing more information to people. So we all know now about this five a day. I think that there is no one in the UK who doesn't know that he has to eat five fruit and vegetables a day, because we have been really hearing this information quite a lot. But again, if I hope that this is now quite clear and obvious that if we have all these behavioral biases and so on, getting information, giving information to people is not what is going to solve the problem. So it's the idea that, and this is why it is important to understand what determines these behaviors, is because you can actually waste quite a lot of money with, say, the wrong policy, targeting something that is not actually not at the core of the problem. So this is what I want to finish with. So what I'm hoping to do in the future and in my future sort of work is to use insights from behavioral economics to design and test policies. I just want to briefly thank my collaborators on a number of health-related projects. So Jonathan James, Patrick Nolan, Valeria Scafida, Noim Berlin, Elenia Pacciarotti, Hannah Behrendt, Aniko Bira, and Jonas Allem. And I will also thank my husband, Philipp Kircher, for useful comments on an earlier version of my presentation. Thank you very much.
And while you're all thinking, I'm going to just take the liberty of asking Michele a question myself. So start thinking, get your hands up while I fire off a quick question here. So I'm very interested to what extent we might start looking at early life. You know, I'm thinking about some of my choices being very much influenced by that little voice in my head, which is my mother's going, you really must exercise more, Philippa, you'll feel so much better for it. So are people starting to think about what programming events happen early in life, whether, you know, parental guidance does play out later?
No, yes, definitely. So thank you very much for this question, actually, because also part of my work is related to this idea of early interventions. And when it comes to, well, it depends a bit about, you know, what types of behaviors we are talking about. But for example, for nutrition, it's something that we believe is potentially very important, is that habits and dietary habits in particular are formed early on in life, and that may indeed influence your behavior for the rest of your life. So this idea of how, and when it comes to other determinants of health-related behaviors like risk preferences and time preferences and so on, this is something that we are in behavioral economics very interested in studying. So how these preferences might be shape early on in life by perhaps your parents or your peers or your environment, and may indeed then be hard to actually change
to
later
away.
On.
Yeah. No, I think that's important. So, question over here.
You mentioned the example of cake versus fruit salad, and I think the food industry worked out a long time ago something that psychologists know now, is that there's a major flood in the brain of the reward centers when you have 50% carbohydrate, 50% fat, sugar, and so on. And that's a neurophysiological response that answers the idea as to why so many people prefer the cake. Does behavioral economics tend to look in a multidisciplinary way to other areas to fill in some of the blanks that you mentioned as to the rationale or lack of rationale that that can be seen when analyzing behavior? And also, does behavioral economics look for behavioral biases for climate change as well as health?
Wow, that's thank you very much for the big question right at the end. No, so certainly I think that behavioral economics at the moment is pretty much an interdisciplinary business, in a sense. So there are lots of places where people work in collaboration with psychologists and with neuroscientists. So it's not only about, for example, understanding, say, food behavior and so on, but also understanding, you know, how these preferences work, time preferences, risk preferences, and so on. It's something that I think we can learn a lot by understanding more neurophysiological mechanisms, biological mechanisms, and again, this is really an interplay between the two. I think behavioral economists, in a sense, have no problems also thinking about, you know, there might be indeed things like impulse and so on that determine what you reward, what you are attracted by, what you are rewarded by definition, actually, almost. So we have no problem thinking about that. I think that perhaps what psychologists and behavioral economists have tried to contribute to the debate is also think about additional biases that are more sort of cognitive biases in decision making. And again, it is going to be an interplay because neuroscientists have a lot to say about these cognitive biases as well, but I think this is really very much an interdisciplinary enterprise. Now, regarding climate change, so is this something, I think, again, so I'm not directly working on climate change, but all these lifestyle behaviors, and particularly when it comes to food, is something that is also directly relevant for indeed the environment and so on. So again, there is no, it's not that behavioral economics is only working on health, obviously, so it's working on behavior in general. And so this is definitely among the things that people are working on as well. It's not something I'm working on directly, but it's something that behavioral economists are interested in.
Hi. First of all, thank you for the presentation. That was very interesting. I myself are interested in behavioral economics in retirement space. And as we see now, auto-enrollment with the default solution, so many people started saving for retirement and now it is compulsory it became. Do you think it would be possible to do something in the food industry? However, what we need here, very highly regulated. So if there will be banned fish and chips or fat tax or anything like this?
Yes, so I think it is definitely, I mean, this is my hope at least, that it is possible to use insights from behavioral economics to design effective policies. I think it is always, when it comes to thinking about which policies are actually most suited, I think this is where we need, you know, evidence, and also there is a bit of a political issue here as well that one needs to be aware of and understand, is that if you're talking about regulation and limiting indeed people's choices and so on, it is a little bit more a kind of nanny state type of policies than it is. So this is why, again, these nudges have been quite popular, because in a sense they don't say change your choice set, they just affect, you know, what is the default option. And that's the example that you also probably have from retirement decisions. So I think these policies are easier to implement and pass from a sort of political perspective.
You said at the beginning that there was this quite clear distinction between, let's say, poorer people and maybe richer people. So, and obviously if you research it, then it could be that the rational choice is a different choice, or the components of the rational choice are different between poorer people and richer people. But also it could be that the biases are different in those cases. Can you say a bit more about that, about the research going on, or
Certainly the case, and so it's something. Again, there is work on trying to understand to what extent these mechanisms differ across income groups or education groups. And so, as I briefly mentioned, I don't know if my microphone is still working. Yes, when it comes to say the determinants of the rational choice, so patience and risk behavior, is something that has been researched and has been established that indeed it seems that high educated people tend to be more patient and tend to be less risk-taking than people who have a lower income. Now, of course, it's a correlation. It's not necessarily it's hard to see what is causing what really, but at least you have this association that you find. When it comes to other biases, so the question of whether maybe there is low-income people are more likely to be vulnerable to, say, the present bias, for example, it's something, again, there seems to be some evidence that this is the case, and that maybe there is a relationship between the magnitude of these biases and your socioeconomic status. But I find, again, what is difficult about this area is to really understand what is causing what and where should we intervene. And so, again, it's an interesting avenue of research, yes.
How far do you consider behavioral economics research to be vulnerable to misuse of its conclusions by companies or governments? And how far do you think that that's actually important and can be seriously dangerous?
Thank you for the question. I think it is true that particularly when it comes to nudges, it comes across a bit as like you're manipulating people, and we know there is actually a whole industry, you know, in marketing with paid by firms actually who are trying to understand, well, how can we actually steer your behavior in one direction or the other. So it's certainly, I personally think that we have a lot to gain to understand what determines people's behaviors. I think that it is, there is of course a risk that while you understand, you know, behavior, there is actually a chance that the companies and the industry may hijack the results. On the other hand, there is clearly a market for them to actually try to dig out, you know, to try to understand these behaviors. So they'll do it anyway. So what we can try to do, at least as academics, is to also perhaps make proposals of ways you can use these insights in perhaps a welfare improving way, and to make suggestions to policymakers about what could be policies that could be welfare improving.
Could you give some examples of what you mean by nudges?
So example of nudges are, for example, you change the canteen. It's something that's it's quite a common and well-known example, but there are people who have looked at, you know, school canteens and have looked at the way the things are presented in the school canteen and how that may affect choices. So again, if you didn't have behavioral biases, you know, you would just go to the canteen and choose whatever you prefer. But what people have shown is that it's very important where things stand. So for example, you know, where the broccoli is situated, that will be important for choices. And so this is an example of you actually change the way things are presented, but you're not changing the choice set. That's an example.
What policy impact have the Behavioural Insight team had so far in the UK?
That's a good question. So they are still quite young. So to be fair, I'm not sure it's, you know, the time to evaluate yet what they have achieved. But they are certainly have been quite influential in a number of domains. And so I know their work well. I interact with them quite a bit. And I think that it will probably grow also in the future, in a sense that, for example, one of the things that they have done in the recent years is to test things that are, well, lots of nudges in different contexts, and or perhaps, you know, things like sending letters to people and telling them about what their neighbors are doing and try to encourage, say, pro-social behavior in this way. And so things that are relatively simple and easy to do. And what I see them doing more recently, and I think is quite interesting, is first of all, they are interested in evaluating what are the long-term effects of these things. So, for example, is it the case that nudges, can you actually be nudged, you know, in the long term? Are you really going to stick to a switch once you have been nudged? So this is one, I think, important question of whether what are the long-term effects of these policies. And also, I think they are trying to do perhaps more work that is using instruments that are not only nudge, but that are more perhaps invasive, or that use taxes, that use programs that are targeting the job seekers and so on. So I think they are doing quite a lot. I think that I personally think it's a good initiative. I think that there have been a bit of a roller coaster, in the sense that the media has been not always, you know, portraying them in a good way by saying, well, this is the policymakers who want to manipulate us and so on. And I think it's somewhat, you know, unfair to draw these conclusions. I think that they are certainly, I think it is quite a promising group of people, and we'll see what happens. I don't think I can evaluate yet.
Gentleman near the back.
Yes, I'd just like to probably ask if there's anything been looked at in terms of the effects of globalization and developing countries or less developed countries being affected by aid or things coming from the outside, because there's an example given of the Marshall Islands that before the Second World War, they had a good diet of fish and vegetables, but when the Americans came in, they found chocolate and cola, and now the country's diet has changed completely. So has anything been looked at in terms of the effects of outside influences in globalization and development?
Yes, so it's a little bit outside what I know, but I'll tell you what I know. So it's certainly the case that what we see is when developing countries develop, they tend to adopt are more likely to adopt something that looks like the Western diet. And then they also tend to develop these, the same diseases as the diseases that have been more prevalent in the West. So it's something that has been looked at, yes, so it's something that indeed seems to be, you know, true that once you have, say, westernization of the diet, you actually get more diseases, and that tends to be associated with opening trade and so on. But I'm really not an expert at all in the effects of trade on diet and lifestyle and so on. So it's all I can say.
Sugar is one of the most addictive drugs on the planet. A supermarket chain put sugar in most of their products, including the raw chicken. How much tax can we put on sugar?
Well, I don't think I can answer this question, but I think it is coming back to the issue of indeed if we have sort of biological reasons why we might be attracted to sugar. There's certainly the case that the industry, if they can, will try to exploit that and develop products that are high in sugar. I think, again, as policymakers, you have, you know, choices to make of how you want to intervene and how you want to perhaps, you know, change this situation, whether you want to regulate producers or whether you actually want to perhaps act on the consumers is a choice that policymakers have. I think that what we can do in behavioral economics is just try to inform what are the possible instruments and how effective they might be. But I cannot, you know, I don't know what the answer is to the question of how much tax you can put on sugar, but it's a good question.
Gentleman here in the front.
You mentioned the example of if you take a pound from me, I'll feel sore and upset and get angry about it. If you give me a pound, I'll think it's just a bit of good luck, and I won't value it as highly. You're using money there as a sort of measure or a marker of how people feel about things, but there must be many other values that we can apply to these sort of judgments: gratification, pain, pleasure.
Yeah.
How much does how we measure things influence the outcome of what you're talking about, gain or loss?
So, okay, thank you. That's an interesting question. It's a good question, I think. So I think it is true that what is important or what is useful when you are doing this type of research is to try to indeed have a metric when you can compare indeed what happens. So perhaps we'll give you another example that is again involving money, but is involving another good. So that's perhaps also another, you know, domain we are talking about. So if you give a good to people, so you give a mug, for example, then and I'm asking you beforehand, how much would you like to pay for the mug? You're going to give me, you know, a price. And if I give you the mug, actually, and I'm asking you, where can you sell it back to me? And you will tell me a price. The price you will mention is actually higher than the price you mentioned at which you were ready to buy it. So it's something that is again, quite known, that somehow, again, if something is a good, it's something that provides you utility, and somehow you value it differently. It's true that it's easier to talk about how people value things when we have a metric, so whether it's, you know, a monetary metric or something else. I think, again, it's something more that psychologists have done to try to look at things like pain and or, you know, other ways you can think about rewards, and again, it's something that is quite well established, this fact that losses weigh heavier than rewards, and it's something that has been established in other domains, so it's not just about the examples that I gave.
There are two celebrities around who've stirred up a bit of controversy recently by trying to suggest that healthy foods are purely behavioural. And there was Jamie Oliver, who did a food program which attracted quite a lot of criticism, in which he appealed to low-income families that they too could eat healthy. And Katie Hopkins, who recently put on 4 stone to prove that she could lose it again, just to make us all jealous. So what I wanted to ask is there benefit? Is there benefit in trying to change the behaviours of low-income people who are more likely to eat fatty foods without addressing the economic need to actually reduce the cost of healthy foods within our supermarkets? Or do you really need to do both before you start seeing real social progress?
Okay, no, so thank you. I think it's an interesting question of to what extent indeed things like, you know, prices and budget are actually determinants of say unhealthy behaviors in the first place. When it comes to food, it's certainly something that people mention a lot, and it's quite, you know, recurrent in discussions that maybe it's actually a question of being able to afford things. So I think there is the studies do show that yes, maybe eating healthier is on average a little bit more expensive than eating healthily. But I think that there is also a lot of work that has been done also by people in public health and in policy as well to show that you could potentially eat healthily on a low budget. And I think that's very much what Jamie Oliver, you know, it's a sort of a whole mission is about, is to show that you can eat healthily on a low budget. But I would agree with you that it's not the case that we just need to think about, say, nudges or a bunch of behavioral biases and not think about, you know, a bigger picture question. I think there is, for me at least, there's also perhaps another important question, which is related to the amount of inequality that you have in society and how that may actually influence things like sentiments of insecurity, stress, and so on, and then and then have an influence on the behaviors of people. So I think that, yes, there are other things that we should take into account, and these economic considerations are very important as well.
And I just have the last question here.
Hello, thank you for this talk. The US invests much more in healthcare than Greece, but still the life expectancy in both countries is the same. Why do you think this is happening? What are the main factors?
Okay, thank you for a very big question and the end. So I think, yeah, again, it's probably, you know, there's not one single answer to this question. The countries are very different in their healthcare system, but they are different in many, many, many dimensions. So I'm actually not too sure when it comes to, say, these lifestyle factors. I would expect that the US is still probably not doing well. The US is always on top of all the tables when it comes down to unhealthy lifestyle behaviors. But I'm not sure. I don't know the Greek situation well enough to comment on that and on the distinction. But it's certainly what you perhaps point out, that is that we don't have a one story, one explanation that can explain, you know, why countries are doing better than others. It's again, perhaps at the risk of stating the obvious, it is probably a combination of explanations, yes.
Well, I want you to join me. Thank you, Michele, for what's been a really stimulating opportunity to think about this very complicated project. I'm sure we've all learned a lot, and I hope everyone will go away and think about five a day and all those things we thought we had choice to do. Thank you, Michele.